Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Write On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. On today's episode, our producer, Kayla Guess, who also serves as the director of the Big Break Screenwriting Contest, is talking to screenwriting career consultant and longtime prize sponsor of our contest, Lee Jessup. Kayla Guess.
Hi, Lee. We have you on today to talk about what it is that you do for a living. You are a screenwriting career coach. What does that mean?
I work with writers, traditionally mostly screenwriters, but I do work with some directors as well, looking at their writing through a business-driven point of view. So I don't look at one script at a time. I don't look at it in a point of view as a story consultant or script consultant would, which is, let's just look at the one script and make the one script as great as we can, but rather, if we want to build a career, if we want to manage a career, if we want to accelerate a career, what are the steps that we need to take? What do we need to do? Some kind of screenwriting support system, if you will, for the industry side of it all, the business side of it all. Does that make any sense?
It does. Well, it makes sense to me because I've worked pretty closely with you with our contest, which you have supported for as many years as we've lost count. And it's really lifted up the profile of our contest too, obviously, because you not only provide intake sessions, you do a one-hour webinar with all of our finalists. You do some grooming for our grand prize winners before we take them out on the water bottle tour. Can you get into what that looks like for people that, first of all, don't know what a water bottle tour is and what does it mean to groom?
Just to add on to that, I also do, which I'm sure you, in your head, it's with the intake. I do some ongoing coaching with the category winners, which is awesome. But the water bottle tour and the grand prize winners, one of the things that I love about Final Draft that I don't really know anybody else who does this, which is why you guys just can't shake me now. You've had me for all these years and I just won't go away. You get the writers this really great exposure with the industry. You set up a lot of meetings, their celebratory lunch with a lot of managers. So it's really the writer's opportunity to start to connect with the industry, make meaningful relationships, connect with people, get to know managers they can potentially work with now, maybe work with in the future, but really you start building their network on, or grow the network that they already have in place. So for me, I just want to help the writers put their best foot forward as they do this water bottle tour of going sometimes to 4, 5, 6 meetings a day with different management companies or managers. Some of them will be manager producers to really talk about who they are, what they do in a concise and focused fashion, because I want to help them be memorable to the people that they're meeting with. You have to remember that people in this industry can meet upwards of 20 writers a week. So how do you remember? How does a person resonate with you? So I try to talk to the writers about their personal narrative, their personal log line, how they present themselves in a memorable way that moves away from stories like, you know, I grew up, I had no friends. I always loved going to the movies or watching TV because I felt like that was where I found my people. So I went to film school and now I'm in LA and I'm trying to break in. It's a perfectly valid story, but it's not a story that is unique in that a lot of people who are here in Los Angeles specifically, but really writing anywhere in the world, do so because of the love for film and television, solace that content provided at some point in their life, many of whom have gone to film school, not everybody, but it's a rather forgettable track because it's so common these days.
Right.
So we try to find the writer's more unique story that is solely theirs. Not everybody's going to have the I ran away to the circus story, right? Great story to tell, but not one that everybody has. The story can be more anecdotal in nature, more episodic in nature, but we just want to, in kind of 45 to 90 seconds, give the person the writer is sitting with something to hang on to that is unique and memorable about the writer and makes them curious to get to know more. One of the great managers who's associated with the contest is a gentleman by the name of Marcus Gorg, who's one of the heads over at Heroes and Villains. He's an incredibly eloquent man. And years ago when I interviewed him, he said something that stuck with me all these years later. And granted, we all hear versions of this from different people. But the way that he positioned it was, we were talking about, what do you expect from a writer when they come into a meeting with you? And he said something like, you're a storyteller. Your very first story is your own story. If you can't tell your own story, how do you expect me to trust you with content that you're less familiar with?
Wow.
Which to me was just very powerful and very telling. And very instructive in terms of what writers need to be ready to talk about. And so that's some of the preparation that we do with a water bottle tour that we take the two very lucky winners of the final draft contest on.
What do you do with the people that maybe don't embrace sharing their origin story? What is your method there? How do you sell that to them?
Ultimately, the moment you go on a meeting or two, you realize that either you capture a person's attention or not. So I will always really try to impress on the writer, the person that is coming out with us, whether it's in my one-on-one coaching or with you guys, that your job is to connect and be memorable. It's really hard to connect when you don't share anything personal. It's really hard to build a relationship of substance without sharing anything of substance, without letting somebody in. So if you're ready to kind of forfeit the meeting and say, okay, I'm not going to go, or I'm going to go and I'm not going to connect. And so, yeah, that ultimately is in the writer's hands, but connection comes on some level of revelation, some level of sharing. The word that comes to mind, while I say it with a caveat, is intimacy, creating some air of get to know you. I'm really letting you into who I am. Now maybe you can do the same and maybe we can create a relationship of substance here. I find that people that don't want to engage in that find fairly early on that just eyes and attention turns away from them. And I think it would be particularly difficult in a big break scenario where if you are the grand prize winner, you are going with another writer. So we've certainly had past years where we had one writer, and this is, I'm thinking a few years back, we had one writer who was really reluctant to share, really felt very disingenuous, somewhat rehearsed. And we had another writer, his counterpart on the winner's circle, who was very open, very kind of easy to jump into the deep end as far as stories and exchanges. And you saw the different reactions in the room. Come to think of it, we've had that more than once. And I think that ultimately, you find that the writer who's more reluctant will then try to
circle back,
catch up. Yeah, catch up, because ultimately, when you go on a meeting on your own and you choose to not be revelatory and not share information, it's up to you, right? You want to blow the meeting, or you can kind of think about, okay, well, I got around it by doing X, Y, Z. But when you have another writer right next to you who's doing what you should be doing, it's hard not to be instantly aware of that.
And that silence really does speak volumes to the manager, right? Because if they're not willing to share that origin story, then the manager might also be going down the path of, well, if they aren't willing to be open with me, how are they going to be receptive to my notes?
And it goes beyond that, right? Because when you go into a meeting, into a general meeting, right? Or if you go into a manager meeting specifically, anytime you're meeting with rep, but it's true for production companies as well, because the reality is the person that you're meeting with will always try to sell you up somewhere else, right? So if you're sitting with an agent or a manager and they're saying, tell me about yourself, and you're giving them nothing, they're going to think, oh, I can't put them in a room with my executive friends. I can't send them in for a general. I can't send them to build out relationships with executives in the city when they're giving me nothing.
Right.
And it's the same thing with development executives, with producers. Very few people in this town have the decision-making power to say, I choose you, I'm going to work with you, I'm going to give you the money, I'm going to give you the project, I'm going to give you the job if it's a staffing job, et cetera, et cetera. Usually there are gatekeepers that you meet with first, be they development executives, studio executives, lower level producers on a show, whatever it is, whoever's taking on some responsibility in vetting who's being brought up to the decision maker, be they a producer, an executive, a showrunner, et cetera, et cetera. If they don't feel that you're connecting with them, in all likelihood, they're going to be like, they're going to have the position of, I'm not going to put this person up in front of my superior because it's going to look bad on me.
Yeah. And if you can't connect with someone in person, how will your writing be able to connect with audiences?
Absolutely. I mean, writing well, writers are encouraged to write beyond the scope of their immediate day-to-day knowledge, whether it be taking that knowledge and blowing it up, right? Applying it to other worlds, other characters, whatever it is, or completely world building. There is a requirement in writing that not every writer is comfortable with, that you are looking for authenticity. We require for the material to feel authentic and genuine. And the only way to get there that I know is by investing the writer's personal experiences, personal cares, themes of interest, characters that inspire them into that work to give them that authenticity. Even if a writer says, okay, this is all entirely removed for me, but thematically I'm excited about it, that alone can become a meaningful investment in the material. And if an executive is getting from a writer that he or she is disingenuous and impossible to penetrate, then it's going to be a little bit more difficult to make a case for why they're the writer for a particular job, for an assignment, for an opening in a room. It just becomes that much more difficult. And I go back to a very simple idea, which is, as much as a lot of writers, specifically feature writers, write alone in a room and love it that way and prefer to stay in their pajamas all day and write and write and write, and I appreciate that, this is a relationship-driven business, and people want to work with other people that they like, that they're excited about, that they're excited to put in front of other people. Everybody wants to be associated with a talented, exciting writer who brings material and ideas and experiences to the table that are unique and authentic. Now, I know I'm rambling on a little bit, so bear with me. Because the big change that's happened in the industry, or one of them over the last 20 years, is that it's really no longer just about the script. It's about, why is the writer to write that script? Whether it's a feature or a TV show, as far as creating an original pilot, or even going into the room, why is the writer the right writer? What personal experience or interests are they bringing into the room to bring value? So it's no longer just about what's on the page. Building a career today, rather than just writing one good script, is about not only showing up on the page, but also being the right writer for the right job.
What is the most interesting, or I guess exciting, origin story you've heard? Can you share that?
I've heard so many. I mean, I've worked with writers who come out of organized crime. I've worked with writers who, someone that you're familiar with, ran drugs across Europe.
Got poisoned with potatoes.
Exactly. A little stone poisoning goes a long way. I really have worked with so many writers who have those big stories, right? And sometimes when you go into a room and you tell about your life in organized crime, it can kind of silence the room real fast. So there's really a question of, how do you tell those stories? But I also have writers that come from much simpler beginnings and have found a way to tell those stories. I mean, I recently worked on a personal narrative with a writer who always thought he would be an astronaut, went to space camp a number of times, met some of the kind of premier astronauts of our times, was on a first name basis with them, but ultimately didn't excel in some of the subjects required to succeed in the pursuit of space. And so turned his attention to storytelling, where he continues to kind of be that same explorer that he always wanted to be. It was heartbreaking. It was difficult for him to realize that he won't be the man that he thought he would become because of some challenges to his own intellect, but still found a way to continue that exploration on his own. And really kind of beautiful, simple story. Again, not everybody was going to go down that route. I think it's not about comparing yourself to other people's stories and saying, well, I never went to space camp and I didn't have that privilege, and therefore I will, you know, I'm not that interesting. But it's really about finding.
But how many shows and features are there in the world of space and on ships? Who knows? Maybe they come up with a project for Space Force and he's the guy to build that world.
Exactly.
What does that look like? That's the thing. I mean,
when we had the final draft launch this past, I guess it was beginning of or end of January.
Feels like a year ago.
Yeah, feels like a lifetime. We ended up going around the table, and we do this a lot during the lunches, where we will ask questions of the managers and have them jump in and kind of educate our writers and share information, because we want to make sure that they get as much from, that the writers get as much information from it as they can, even if they don't end up working with any of the managers at the table. Having 10, 12 managers at a table is such a wealth of knowledge and information. So we ended up going around the table and talking about branding the writer, picking a genre. And I know a lot of writers have a resistance to it. Why do I have to do one thing? And one of the things that I believe Marcus, again, Marcus Gorg said at the table was, you should be so lucky as to be pigeonholed, right?
Right. That's a great point.
Yeah. So it's, you know, you should be so lucky that the industry knows what you do best and brings you in for that. And in truth, I mean, I've seen that with all of my writers who then, of course, want to break out of whatever box they're put into. But having a box to step into is kind of the first step that you need for the career, because it implies an understanding of what you do best, what speaks to you, whether it's writing the female point of view or writing material from a legal standpoint because you have experience as a federal prosecutor. Hmm. Of course, you then can and do often want to break out of it, but a career, a real solid career with promise of longevity starts with some sense of being pigeonholed so that you can then break out of that realm. And that's where, yeah, you can start on sci-fi shows. That particular writer could start on sci-fi shows or could start on anything that has to do with space exploration, but then can go into something different and smaller with the moment that they're established and people will read anything from them.
Sure. There's definitely the hybrid genres out there. So over the last 20 years, you have obviously worked with, I'm going to say, hundreds, thousands of writers. How many? What kind of success?
A lot
of writers. I certainly send everyone I know your way. What kind of success have you seen your writers have over the years?
Oh, amazing success. I mean, it's really a privileged position, right, to kind of be able to sit, support, and watch writers as they break in. I'm fortunate in that I get to work with some big writers who are working writers, who are arrived to me already at some of the top levels of the industry. Mm-hmm. And it's really a joy to work with them and support them. But my heart has always been with writers breaking in. It's just the happiest thing for me.
Why do you think that is?
Because I think watching somebody go from a stance of hardworking, hopeful optimism to tangible results and hitting those milestones of getting representation, getting the first job, getting the second job, selling a show, selling a feature, becoming a showrunner, like those things, it's just such a satisfying thing to watch for me. Mm-hmm. Because I love the underdog, and I feel like everybody in the industry effectively who's trying to break in is an underdog in some way.
Yeah.
I really love rooting for people who work hard against what can feel sometimes like insurmountable odds, but get through anyway. You hear so much in the industry about how impossible it is to break in, how tough it is. And it is impossible and it is tough, but mm-hmm. I have the luxury of seeing it happen all the time.
Yeah.
And which is a great luxury.
What is your method with writers? So I know that everyone has a different touch. You know, we have so many career consultants out there. We obviously have you, we have Jen Gersanti, we have Pilar Alessandra.
Well, Jen and Pilar do mostly story. They tend to stick closer to script, and I tend to go really over career. So I actually share a lot of clients with both Pilar and Jen and a bunch of other consultants out there who are brilliant people. And frankly, you know, when I came into the space, I came from development and having run scriptarc.com and having written in my past and being lucky enough to get something picked up. But I felt like there's so many people in the story space.
Right.
We really don't need one more. It was really kind of my take on it, which is where I wanted to look at career efforts and really how a career is constructed. Mm-hmm. Right. Ultimately, what I love about my job is that every writer is different. And there's no one sure path to breaking in. So it keeps me on my toes. It makes me constantly have to think and re-examine what we're doing with a particular writer to help them push forward. And
that keeps it interesting, right? Because every client that you have, you know, is going to be a new journey that you haven't seen before.
Absolutely. It's not only is a writer unique in what they write, they also bring with them unique past experiences. They also have a unique personality combination. So they can be really motivated, but terribly insecure. They can be incredibly confident, but really freeze socially. You're always dealing with some unique mix of ingredients to create that writer and that writer's endeavors. Listen, I have a writer who moved to LA 2 years ago and just over, and ultimately, like, moved out and told me, like, from the beginning, she's an introvert, she's antisocial, she wants to be a TV writer, which kind of makes me go, she worked really hard to get out of her comfort zone. There was one day that she told me that it was a Saturday, I think shortly after she moved here, where she decided to stand outside of her apartment or sit on the stoop outside of her apartment and start a conversation with every person that walked by. Wow. And she did that a whole day.
Wow.
And she had me at hello. Like, I was so in love with that story and so fascinated by this person who's obviously creative in challenging herself, but willing to step out of her comfort zone to overcome a weakness in the way that she could show up. Fast forward to where we are now, she just started the Disney ABC fellowship, super talented, and she's on her way. Like, this is a person who's really overcome a deficiency.
And by the way, that's no small feat. The Disney ABC fellowship is very, very tough to get into.
Are you kidding me? It's 8 people out of like 3,000 get in. It's a paid fellowship for a year. Mm-hmm. Staffing likelihood is very, well, because the program sponsors you, you're very likely to end up in a room, which is the hardest thing to do as far as breaking into TV. So I love watching what writers are willing to do to challenge themselves. I love watching the evolution of writers, what they learn, where they adjust, how they pivot. And, you know, it's just because it's not a one size fits all, right? Because there isn't do these 3 steps until you break in and everything will be fine. It keeps it super interesting.
What's the biggest challenge you've had in terms of someone that you've worked with? Like, maybe they weren't excited about rolling up their sleeves, because we have managers, you know, that support the contest. Again, we're bringing up Marcus. We should have just had him on this episode. When we met with them this year, he mentioned that he has his new writers deliver 2 feature scripts and 2 TV scripts every year until they don't have the time because they're too busy on paid projects. So what would you say has been a challenging experience with a client, and that you've can get into that a little bit?
Sure. I'll start it with kind of a caveat that I think I'm really fortunate in that a lot of people come to me through word of mouth, from people that I've worked with who understand what my expectations are of my writers. I always tell my writers, you have to want your writing career more than I do. If you don't, if I'm the one who's cracking the whip and going, why aren't you writing? What's going on? It's a problem. But most of the people that show up to work with me show up with some expectation of, okay, you're really going to have to show up and do the work. For me, the difficult thing, the challenging thing, becomes when writers talk about writing and talk about the career and talk about where they want to be and talk about where they think they're ready to go, right? I'm ready for representation. I'm ready to staff. I'm ready for my first feature writing assignment. Without having the work to back it up and without putting in the work and the time on a consistent basis to really earn it. So that can be somebody who wrote a script that did well for them 2-3 years ago, but have not written anything since. And the industry, you know, there's a reason everybody always asks, show me the next thing. Nobody says, show me the last thing, right?
Right.
Because the understanding is you get better from script to script. So those writers who kind of rest on their laurels, I wrote a good thing, it got some good feedback. Mind you, it didn't get me as far as it should, but let's see what it can do now. Mm-hmm. That tends to drive me crazy because writers should be writing.
Right.
And that writers, the beauty of writing is that writers don't need an audience, right? Writers don't need a crew. Writers need a page. Writers need the ability to sit down in front of the computer and come up with something new. They can reinvigorate their career. They can create new opportunity for themselves. They can restart conversations. They can create new conversations, all with the power of writing. So the other side of that is that I've seen too many writers over time talk about wanting to write, wanting to staff, wanting to do all of those things, but without having the samples to really back it up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen that myself.
Yeah, or saying like, yeah, I want to be a writer, but not putting in the hours. When I talk to writers who work a normal 40-hour job, who don't have kids, who don't have a spouse or a partner, who, you know, go out some but are not social animals, who tell me that they can give me 5 hours of writing per week, my take is usually, well, you probably don't want to write that badly. Because the flip side of that is that I have writers who have a full-time job and 4 kids and a wife on disability and are waking up at 5:30 in the morning or 4:30 in the morning to give me 2 or 3 hours a day every day before the day starts. Because they understand that if we're talking about the idea of 10,000 hours to mastery, not to say that you have to get all the way to 10,000 hours, but your craft and your talent grows and increases the more that you do it, they're going to make a dent in that. They're going to give me 15, 20 hours a week, 12 hours a week without blinking. Mm-hmm. And those are people that don't have the time. So writers have to understand that, yes, they do the best they can with what they have. And not every writer is meant to sit down and write 8 hours a day. Very few are actually capable of that.
Sure.
And you have to juggle your personal life and your job and whatnot. But ultimately, writing has to be a priority. It has to show up as a priority. And that at the end of the day will show up in the number of hours that you sit and write, and the number of pages that you produce, and whether or not you get to a place where you can very ambitiously, as Marcus said, produce 2 pilots and 2 features a year. That is super ambitious.
And there's many ways that the reputation that just of knowing you personally and listening to the conversations that you've had with some of our writers, I would say I would describe you as someone who eliminates every excuse we can possibly come up with. I would use much stronger language, but I have to mind the brand that I'm with. But I work with some writers myself, and he knows exactly who he is that I'm talking about right now. That same excuse, you know, it works 40 hours a week, doesn't have a kid, doesn't have a partner, and is still working on the same script that we've been talking about for a year. Mm-hmm. It's a very common thing. And I think that maybe it's not so much just that they shouldn't be writing, or maybe they just don't understand what it really does take to be a working writer in this industry. And that's why they should come see you, so that you can unveil that for them and help them, you know, enlighten them basically on what it really does take.
The reality is that I understand it's scary to get your work out there. You've worked on it really hard. You put your heart and soul into it. What if you send it out for reads and everybody hates it? What if you put it in Final Draft Big Break contest and it doesn't get anywhere? That's a scary reality.
Sure.
But there's also an opportunity there, which is discovering whether or not the work is good enough and what it needs to go through in order to reach the next level. Because if there's one complaint that we hear about fairly consistently in this industry, specifically from people who are on the forefront of discovery, so managers definitely fit that criteria, is that there's a lot of good stuff out there and very little that's great. Mm-hmm. So if your material is being entered into Big Break or any other major contest, Nickel or whatever, and not cracking quarterfinals, there's a problem there. Take a step back, evaluate, talk to friends who are readers who are ahead of you, hire people for reads. Like, do what you have to do to go from good to great. Don't settle for good, because great is what breaks through. And I can tell you that when work is great, it starts moving around on its own. I was talking to a writer yesterday who wrote a pilot that I read over the weekend that I really, really liked. I thought it was really strong. And he had told me that he just signed with an agent and a manager. And I said, okay, how did this happen? He told me how the people just started passing around the work without necessarily asking a lot of questions, just kind of saying, hey, I read it, I love it, can I give it to a couple of people? And before you know it, mind you, this is a person who's in LA, who is an assistant in a writer's room. So he has some industry connections, and I understand the value of that. But before you know it, the few people who he knew, and mind you, these were not people that he knew from his room, these were people that he knew socially, mm-hmm. were passing it around. People want to get excited about great scripts. There's this idea that Hollywood just wants to say no. Yeah, Hollywood wants to say no to spending money, but Hollywood wants to say a big fat yes to exciting new voices.
Sure. I think they want to say yes more than they want to say no.
Absolutely. And, you know, we look for material to be undeniable, but we're looking for voices to be unique and exciting and special and different. One of my writers just signed with a manager. Friday was a double whammy day. I had 2 writers, both signed, separate writers signed.
Congratulations.
With It was just one of those fun days where you're like, yeah, it's a Friday. It's great.
Awesome.
And it was the bonus on that was that everybody that I met with that morning, I had like 6 back-to-back meetings, were all represented, working, going on to the next assignment, yada, yada. So it was one of those where you're like, oh my God, everybody's taken care of. This is so great.
That's so fantastic. That's so fantastic.
No, it was great. But it was just one of those days where ultimately 2 writers got signed, and they're both writers that I would say that if you met them or you saw them from afar, you would say, okay, they seem like nice people, probably not the most memorable individuals connected, and like definitely not, I wouldn't say either one of them is going to be partying it up at Sundance or whatever, or Austin Film Festival, even though at least one of them has gone in the past. But they're both just nice, hardworking people who know how to talk about themselves, whose work stands out. That's well-crafted, smart, unique takes. And it was really great to see both of these writers recognized and find homes for themselves and for their work, because it's as it should be.
Well, I want to pivot there because we've been talking about you watching your writers grow and get signed mm-hmm. and have all these success stories, major success. What about the managers that you've worked with? You've been in this business for 20 years. You've seen yeah. the Jewel Rosses of the world as assistants. Talk about that a little bit.
Well, Jewel and I actually met shortly after he got on a desk, shortly after he became an agent manager for the first time.
And for those that don't know who Jewel Ross is,
you should,
please.
First of all,
yes, so. You should if you're in this industry, but he's a
tastemaker.
He is a tastemaker. Yes, he really is a disruptive thinker, right?
Yeah, absolutely. He reps Barry Jenkins, and
right.
he reps Matt
again.
Albert,
if you don't know,
yeah, who wrote Coco, and you know he's worked hard to earn his reputation. It's a great, just as shiny as a reputation as one can get. But he and I go back a million years. Just I always say, like, people look at me sometimes and say, "Oh my God, you know everybody in the industry." I don't, but I'm fortunate enough to have met a small amount of the right people over the years who have been, first of all, very kind and inclusive to me and have been good friends to me. And, you know, many of whom went on to end up through one way or another working with some of my writers and taking really good care of them. But yeah, I mean, you see managers grow, you see them evolve, you see their management style evolve as they become more confident. I have one client who has been with a fairly well-known, well-regarded manager, started with this manager when this manager first really started out on his own. And back then, when they started working on a first script together many, many years ago, there was a lot of micromanaging of that idea, right? Really kind of nitpicking it from every direction. Fast forward a few years, we're a few scripts in, and both the writer and the manager have individually gained confidence in what they do. So their development relationship is much less clunky today. But that's an evolutionary thing, right? That when you start out earlier in your career as a manager, as anything, I think you just have less security in your own knowledge of what it is that you're doing and how to best do it. And so your style develops. The way that you develop with your writer evolves. I mean, if we're talking about a Jewel Ross type, like he and I had talked some time ago, this is years ago now, about the things that he was willing to do earlier in his career as a manager and the things that he's willing to do now as far as going out every night and meeting new writers and talking to everyone and doing that thing that you have to do as a young manager versus the things that you then choose to do as an established, successful, taste-making manager. At that point, you are going to go to the big CAA parties but sit out everything else because you can. So you definitely see an evolutionary style. It's a really fascinating time in the industry with what's happening with the ATA and the WGA. The next kind of month and a half is going to be
insane.
Month and 3 days is going to be very big, very telling. It could evolve into like a Y2K nothing,
right?
Or it could blow up the industry. So it's a fascinating time. It's also a fascinating time for managers.
Yeah, it really is.
Because if everything that's threatened with the WGA and the ATA comes to pass, a lot of chips are going to go flying up in the air, and how they land remains to be seen.
Which is why we love working in this industry, because mm-hmm. it is ever changing. And at the end of the day, we get to make stuff up for a living. I'm
yeah,
totally
I mean,
stealing
not
that quote
moment.
From someone. I think I'm stealing that from Larry Karaszewski. I'm not sure, but I think he said we get to make shit up for a living is what he said. So
he's a good person to steal from. So
thanks, Larry. So we have to close this up, and I am going to, I didn't prep you for this. Your services obviously are not free. To those writers that maybe aren't ready to invest in themselves or just mm-hmm. don't have the means or don't understand the value of the investment in services like career coaching, what is one free tidbit you can give to a writer who, you know, we're getting into contest and fellowship season. We just launched our contest. We're in our early bird season. And, you know, we see writers who have never written a script before in their life. They submit that very first one, and then they somehow percolate all the way up to the top of 8,000 or so scripts. And now they have to navigate the world of general meetings. Like, what kinds of things What's a free tidbit you could give them while they're waiting to see the results of this year's contest and fellowship season in terms of working on their origin story or their brand?
One tip? That's tough.
Yeah, it's a freebie. That's all they get.
Write a lot. Find people who are further ahead in their writing specifically, who will give them notes, who will give them harsh notes. Like, find the negative Nellies that will tear down your work, assuming that they know what the hell they're talking about.
Sure.
And figure out how to become a stronger writer so that you can show up for the opportunities that may come your way through a contest or a fellowship. Now, in terms of knowing your brand, you know, if you submitted for, you know, let's just go with a rom-com to Final Draft Big Break Contest, and it's the first script you've ever written, sit down and jot a list of ideas, run those by friends, see which are your best. Are you going to stay in the rom-com space? Do you generate better, more interesting ideas in a different space? Really think about what you're writing and why you're writing it and whether or not you want to write it for the long term as opposed to writing it because it's the first thing that came to mind. If you have to be a brand that produces a product, go back to Apple. Apple started with computers many, many years ago, a long time before their iPods and iPads and everything and iTunes. They were the Think Different campaign, right? They were the personal computer maker, and they were that for a long time before they diversified. So what do you do? What do you do best? What are you most interested in? Watch everything in that space.
What's your
know
pigeonhole?
It really well. Be ready to talk about it, because if you are so lucky as to even just get to the finalists of Big Break, you may get interest from representation, and those people consume content 24 hours a day. You have to find a way to keep up. So know everything in your space, understand your space, understand what the audience is for your space. Understand. I mean, I talked to somebody last week who was like, oh yeah, I wrote this TV movie. It's not a Hallmark or Lifetime. I was like, then what are we talking about?
Where does it go?
Yeah, he was like, yeah, I was thinking NBC. I was like, when's the last time NBC did a TV movie? Come on.
Have your finger on the pulse.
Exactly. Know the industry. You are trying to become part of a living, breathing thing. Read a lot, watch a lot, take in information. Never feel like you know everything you need to. I can tell you, I've been in this business all my life. I've never worked in a different industry. And I'm still always uncovering information for fear of what I don't know. And sure. Let me tell you, it's a lot.
So let's tell people where they can find you online and on social media.
So website is leejessup.com. Twitter is Lee Z Jessup. Facebook. Oh my God. What is my Facebook under? I don't even remember, but I'm there. Lee Jessup Career Coach. I'm sure you can find it. But
and you
yeah,
have your
I'm
own.
Easy to be found. My job is to, you know, people say I need help, to try and show up and help.
And you have your own blog and podcast as well, correct?
I don't have a podcast. I have a blog.
Your blog. You just guest so often. Lee is so entrenched in this industry. She's on every screenwriting podcast. So we'll
yeah,
add in.
So tired of me sooner or later.
Oh no, never. We're married in this. Remember, this is forever.
I know. You stuck with me.
Yeah. We're both celebrating 20 years this year. I didn't realize that as I was, you know, stalking your website again to better prepare for this episode, doing my producer job, I realized that we're both celebrating 20 years this year. We're twins.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right, Lee. Well, thank you so much for being on our podcast. And I look forward to another very successful season with you. I can't wait to see who our next winners are. I can't believe we're already on to that next step, but here we are.
That's always so exciting. I cannot wait. Can't wait for the next winners tour. I love it. I can't tell you how much I love working with winners who have this huge opportunity on their hands. I can't wait to see what they do with it and how they maximize it. It's a really exciting time for writers when they get to where they get to with a contest.
And for us, because we get to be standing behind them, jumping up and down.
Totally.
And thank you to producer Kayla Guess. Thank you to all our subscribers out there. And thanks to everyone who's been leaving us those ratings and reviews on iTunes. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc and Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Until next time, write on.